We're going to snake it, the National League West. We're talking about the NL West. What are the Dodgers going to do with the deadline? Nick Ahmed, is that their big move? I don't know about that. Happy belated Clayton Kershaw Day. We're recording as Kershaw takes the mound, getting ready to go again. But what do the Padres do after Dylan Cease's no-hitter? Holy smokes, we got to talk about that off the top, too. Notable injury in the AL West, but then we also have to hit on the, let's see, the Diamondbacks, the Giants. And I guess a couple minutes on the Colorado Rockies. Jack Peter, just baseball show as always. It's presented by BetMGM. We're going to get into a notable injury in a moment. But before that, do want to tell you about our friends at Game Time one more time. New friend of the show is Game Time. Game Time is now an authorized ticket marketplace of Major League Baseball. That makes getting tickets even faster and easier. Prices on the Game Time app actually go down the closer it gets to first pitch. You get killer last-minute deals, all-in prices, views from your seat, their lowest price guarantee. Game Time takes the guesswork out of buying MLB tickets. You can use it for last-minute deals. I love their all-in pricing. You get concerts, comedy, theater, sports, list goes on. Take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app today. Create an account. Use code JUSTBASEBALL, all caps, one word, for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account, redeem code JUSTBASEBALL for $20 off. Download the Game Time app today. Last-minute tickets, lowest price, guaranteed. I would go to 29 baseball games. I would go to 29 ballparks right now. The only one that I wouldn't is Oakland. Because if they somehow find themselves up in the ninth inning, you're not going to see their guy in the ninth inning. Mason Miller just hit the 15-day injured list with a broken hand. Come on.
Is it one of the massive
possible chips is off the market.
I'm seeing it's like a left finger thing, but the reports from Oakland are weird. I've also seen broken hand. I've also seen left pinky, and I've seen multiple fingers. I don't know exactly what is going on, but it's crazy weird timing for this to happen. It might be a pure coincidence, but the fact that it's happening a week before the deadline is weird to me.
A's PR put out broken left hand. Mm-hmm. Martin Gallegos, who covers the Oakland A's for MLB.com, said, per source, A's will place all-star closer Mason Miller on the injured list today with a fracture of the fifth metacarpal pinky on his left hand. So his left pinky. It's a non-pitching injury he suffered after pounding a padded training room table in frustration following Monday night's win.
Ah, so isn't a coincidence.
No, it's I didn't throw well enough, even though we won, and I got to punch a padded table.
When are we going to learn, folks? And now, the last thing any of these guys need is some fucking fat podcaster just saying, hey, when you're angry, don't punch something. You know that, stupid. Duh, they know that. But at the same time, can I say it? I mean, has anybody ever won against the wall? Devin Williams kicked himself out of a postseason race due to this.
Jared Kelnick lost to the wall recently. I remember when I was younger, Carlos Quentin, the White Sox outfielder, lost to the wall. Didn't Carlos Zambrano lose to a Gatorade cooler? He lost to something.
He's like 0-7 against inanimate objects.
I think the only time that a baseball player has won against an inanimate object was David Ortiz to the bullpen phone. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
He but annihilated. Luckily,
that's what you're supposed to do. Whenever you want to beat the living shit out of something, use a bat. Another one that potentially is a winner. Remember when Aaron Judge ran into the wall at Dodger Stadium?
And they him of another go at 60 homers. I'd say the cement thing underneath that fence won.
Yeah, I agree. But they removed it after it, didn't they? So wasn't it kind of a lose-lose? Because with Mason Miller and all these guys that punch inanimate objects, it's automatically just a straight-up loss. But was Aaron Judge as the first lose-lose? That's something to think about on this Friday.
Probably. This stinks for Oakland because if they had any intention of moving him, they were going to get a king's ransom for it. And now he's off the table. So was it looking more and more unlikely by the day that they were going to move him? Yeah, it was. But does this take all of that away? Yes, it does.
Do you think truly like off the table? Because I kind of agree with you, but I'm not putting 100% on it yet.
I'm not trading for a guy on the IL.
Especially a reliever. And you have to give up a ton for him.
Yeah.
So it makes sense. I don't think it's going to happen either, but I'm not ruling 100% out. Because you don't know what Preller is going to do. You know? Yeah. As long as he's not out for the rest of the season, which I don't think he will be, especially because it's on his non-pitching hand. He just puts that thing in the glove and he throws for one inning anyway.
Yeah.
Maybe a team is willing to potentially trade for Mason Miller, knowing the price might be a little bit lower. I don't know. We're speculating. It's tough to know at this point.
I don't think so. And I think there is some like transactional jargon that is there. Like, hey, you can't trade for certain guys on the injured list, but I think this is a 15, so you might be able to. I don't know the exact, you know, terminology of like if he's even available to be traded right now or not.
But see, this is the trade deadline preview for the National League West. And there's a team in the National League West who seems to not care about all those little details. I'm excited to talk about the Padres.
Yeah. We are going to get to the Padres. We're going to get to the Dodgers. We're going to get to Dylan Cease. One more injury update. Ken Rosenthal just tweeted out, Christian Yelich intends to rest and rehab his back rather than undergo surgery that would have ended his season. Off-season surgery is a strong possibility, according to the source. Again, that's from Ken Rosenthal. So he could just be pushing off-season surgery back. He's pushing the inevitable back, but he's going to try and give this thing a go with the Brewers leading the National League Central. And we're going to talk about the National League Central on the Monday episode. But this is, I don't want to say like, oh, thank goodness it's not, you know, serious, because it is serious and it sounds like it'll require surgery. But if you ever doubted Christian Yelich's level of give a shit and his commitment to winning in Milwaukee, I think he gives a shit. And I think he's really committed to winning in Milwaukee.
100%. And I feel like half of his career has been dealing with some sort of bad injury and still playing through it, right? There are points in Christian Yelich's career where he physically could not. But if he's ever got a nick here or a ache there or, you know, even something more serious like this, like he's going to play through it. And it's going to be hard to watch Christian Yelich expecting the guy who can hit 330, but seeing a guy hitting 270, 260 because of the bad back. But that's just how good he is that I still think that he's going to be a competitive player at the plate with a bad back. And you're right. It just goes to show what kind of warrior he is. And that's why I think a lot of fans gravitate toward Christian Yelich, not just because he's an absolute joy to watch, but you routinely see him deal with these nagging injuries and playing through them. And Brewers fans just got to be happy about this because they need him for the stretch run. He is the engine that makes this team go. Of course, you know, William Contreras has been an absolute monster, but still Yelich's team.
Yeah. Also, you can trade players on the injured list. I just wanted to check that. So you could technically go and acquire Mason Miller. What Bader was traded from New York when he was in a boot, right? It was Jordan Montgomery deal.
Yeah, good call.
Yeah. I was thinking, I was like, where's the precedent here? And of course, my mind went to Harrison Bader, Jordan Montgomery, because why would I do that?
No, because we talked about yesterday, Bryce Miller and Brandon Donovan, that trade is still in your head. You can't let it go. Because
exactly.
It makes so much sense.
Yep. Big leaguer for big leaguer. Let's make somebody really good. So mm-hmm. I hear you on that front. Before we get into the National League West, we have to talk about the second no-hitter in Padres franchise history. First one was Joe Musgrove, the beginning of the 2021 season. And the second no-hitter in Padres history was Dylan Cease on July 25th in Washington, D.C. 3-0 win over the Washington Nationals. Dylan Cease, 9 Ks, 3 walks. He threw 114 pitches, and he hit 99.6 in the ninth inning. This guy's been a dog. What was it? Last 3 starts, opponents are 2-for-65 against him.
In his last 22 innings, he has allowed 2 hits, struck out 30, and allowed no earned runs. Just for 22 innings and 2 hits allowed, no pitcher in MLB history has ever done that. Dylan Cease has a real argument for the greatest 3-start stretch in the history of the league. Unbelievable. unbelievable what he is doing right now. And finally, I can use the word unbelievable and it actually be unbelievable. Because I use that word all the time. It's my fault. I'm hyperbolic. I exaggerate. No. This is deserving of unbelievable. Two hits in his last 22 innings. The first pitcher in MLB history. Unbelievable.
I got to look at the start before or after Johnny Vandermeer's two no-hits, two no-hitters in a row.
Probably
so, like,
shelled.
You got double no-hitter. Yeah, he probably got blasted the start before and the start after.
If he gave up three hits, it wasn't as good as Cease.
Yep, damn right. So when you look at that, when you extrapolate that, that's great. But Vandermeer finished all three, but Cease finished this one too. We were settling into a rhythm of a lot of combined and no-no bids, and that's not fun. That's not sexy.
No.
I love that Dylan Cease finished what he started. And dude, don't look now, but this guy's on the hill all the time, and he's been on the hill all the time. I think since post-COVID, 2021, he was on the hill constantly. 2022, on the hill constantly. 23, on the hill constantly. Dylan Cease is like one of the more available starting pitchers in baseball. And I know that we've talked about that, but 165 innings in 21, 184 in 22, 177 in 23, and now 122 so far this year, not accounting for the no-hit bid. Wow, man. Wow.
Wow, indeed. And I'm glad that he actually finished this no-hitter, because I'm sure he remembers the last time he threw an almost no-hitter, and I'm sure you do too. We were talking about it before we pressed the record button. Bottom of the ninth, two outs. Dylan Cease has a no-hitter against, I think it was the Minnesota Twins?
Yes, it was.
And his now teammate, Luis Arraez, ruined that no-hit bid. He is on the wall of the, with Andres Galarraga. I think that was his name, right? The guy Armando Galarraga. That's on me. That's a non-baseball knower mistake right there.
Andres is the big cat. Armando. Yes.
Armando Galarraga, the guys who almost got a no-hitter. Clean base hit from Luis Arraez. So he finishes this one. So he could have two no-hitters under his belt. But just talking about his availability, it's incredible how he's able to maintain this type of velocity, even being this durable as well. Because you would expect Dylan Cease, who averages around 96 mile an hour on his fastball normally, towards the tail end for it to taper off a little bit. But that's what goes to show in these last three starts too. He is maintaining 98 miles an hour on his fastball on the average, touching triple digits. That type of stuff is as good as any pitcher in Major League Baseball, and that's why he's pitching that way. This guy almost won a Cy Young a few years ago, and I don't think his stuff that he's throwing with right now was worse than what it was in 2020. I think it's better now. I think this current iteration of Dylan Cease on the Padres is the best version that he's had in his career, and this is a career where he almost won a Cy Young. This guy is a bona fide ace, and he sealed it in writing with this no-hitter.
So Cease, I'm trying to figure this out because I think he's ticked up over the last couple of games.
Definitely.
I think he was around, if I'm not mistaken, it was like 95. He was sitting about 95. And then he gets here in 2024. Yeah, he was sitting about 90, 96. All right. So last time out, he was 96.7. But somehow he's ticked up to like 97, 98, consistently grabbing 99, consistently grabbing 100 miles an hour. You see so many hundreds flash up on the score bug on TV, on the K zone. Like, man, if this guy has found that new gear, he can be that game one starter in a postseason series. I think the Padres have their game one starter and they're not thinking twice about it. When he looks like this, he's one of the better pitchers in all of baseball. But let's not sit here and pretend that he is one of the better pitchers in baseball, because this guy had a 4.8 last year, a 4.6, I want to say, last year. And he's rocking like a 3.7 this year coming into that. And yeah, his last three starts have been phenomenal, but we know that Dylan Cease will be out of whack sometimes. So you ride the roller coaster in hopes that the peaks are going to look like this. And guess what? The peaks look like this. That's why he's so insanely valuable.
100%. Yeah, you're right. And I'm talking about, I'm more drinking the Kool-Aid right now.
Yeah, everybody is. But like, shout out Elijah Evans, who does kick-ass work on our socials and does a great job writing at justbaseball.com. And he was like, remember when Dylan Cease wasn't even on Just Baseball's top 20 starting pitchers before the year? Okay, you're saying that after a no-hitter. But do you remember the 4-6 last year?
Yeah.
You remember his 5 walk outings?
Yeah, and coming into this game as well, right? You said it yourself, right? He wasn't coming into this game with a 2-9. He was coming into this game with a 3-7.
Even after 2 phenomenal starts.
Yeah, but this iteration, and Peyton, shouting out another Just Baseball guy who edits this podcast, also runs the TikTok Big League Analysis on our network. He did a breakdown of Dylan Cease, a mechanical change, something in his windup. I have to go back and review it, but I would go check out that video on Big League Analysis on TikTok or on Instagram. He broke it down, and it's unlocking a little bit more velo. And when Dylan Cease is throwing 98 to 100, all he's got to do is throw it in the strike zone, because if you aim middle, it's going to be a couple balls off, and that's good enough because it's 98 to 100 with all of his breaking balls. So what I'm saying is, if this mechanical change that he made sticks for the rest of the year and he's able to maintain this level of velocity, I think those are the two keys, because he's going to have starts where the command isn't really there. But when the stuff is that good, you're going to get more chases than he would otherwise. So for me, the reason I'm drinking the Kool-Aid right now, and maybe I shouldn't be based off past history, but for right now, I'm buying this new Dylan Cease with the elevated velocity. And like I said, if he can maintain this, bona fide ace.
Yeah, I'm with you. All right, time for NL West.
Time for NL West. The trade deadline preview. It's going to be another banger. It is, again, one of those divisions that has two obvious buyers. One team sort of in the middle, but I think they're more of a buyer. Another team that I think is more towards the seller, but potentially buys. And then an obvious seller. It's one of those divisions again.
Yeah. And we start with the LA Dodgers. The LA Dodgers are 61-42 as we record right now. That's going to be different by the time you listen to this. They are 7.5 clear of San Diego. They are the second best record in the National League, only behind the Philadelphia Phillies. They're doing this with 7 starts at an 8 ERA from Bobby Miller, 8 starts at a 5.8 from Walker Buehler, no starts from Clayton Kershaw, no starts from Dustin May, no starts from Emmett Sheehan, no appearances from Bruce Stargraterol. Max Muncy's been out since mid-May. Mookie Betts has been out since mid-June. Yoshinobu Yamamoto has been out for the majority of July. They DFA'd James Paxton, who is 8-2 with the 4.43 ERA. But Gavin Stone has a 3.19 ERA in 101 innings. Landon Knack in 44 innings has a 3.07. Justin Robleski and River Ryan are now in the rotation as well. How do we make this team better? They signed Nick Ahmed off the couch, who was released by the Giants and was in the lineup on Wednesday night against Robbie Ray, who, by the way, went, what, 5 no-hit with 8 Ks? In his return, his first start since March of 23.
Your favorite player, Robbie Ray, dominated the Dodgers off an injury.
It was crazy. I forgot to tweet about it and say, damn, I'm so fired up for this. But, man, the Dodgers, I struggle to kind of compute what the Dodgers have done this year, because we talk about the injury luck from hell that the LA Dodgers have gotten, right? You see Dave Roberts' reaction when Mookie Betts gets hit in the hand with that pitch. He almost throws his hands up and he's like, this again? Come on. The report that Dustin May had a torn esophagus and needed surgery because he ate a bone on a steak? Come on. Oh, it's like Murphy's Law. We're talking about the Murphy's Law Dodgers being 19 games over 500.
Yep.
They will not play 500 baseball because they have Freddie Freeman, because they have Shohei Ohtani, and they always figure out a way to have enough talent, and their stars star enough. I didn't even factor in Will Smith playing like one of the better catchers in all of baseball. They're perfect when they're healthy, but when they're dealt shit blow after shit blow, they're still a World Series contender.
Absolutely. And you know, their winning formula this year, at least it seems to me, is we need 5 innings, 2 runs from our starters. That's all we need. A lot of young guys coming up, maybe innings limit restrictions, stuff like that, or just their guys not going that long outside of Tyler Glasnow, who has also spent some time on the shelf. But even they bring up Yamamoto, and he's not going very deep into games yet too. And it's been on the backs of this bullpen that I think has been freaking dominant. And now they look fully healthy, and it is just such a good bullpen back there. Go ahead.
Dude, Gratterall hasn't even thrown. Gratterall's in Oklahoma City right now in the rehab. So Gratterall's going to come back. Dude, Brent Honeywell looks awesome. Noted closer for the Indianapolis Indians. Looks great in his first five innings with the LA Dodgers.
Anthony Banda, who came from Cleveland, who was like, nobody ever really heard of this guy. He's got a 2.48. He's been awesome as a left-handed reliever in that pen. I think Trinan is as good as any reliever ever. Whenever I watch him, he's one of the guys where I just unnecessarily freak out when I watch the turbo sinker and that insane breaking ball. I just think, to me, I don't know how anybody hits him on the face of the earth. Daniel Hudson's been incredible. Alex Vesia, Evan Phillips has been an absolute dog. I mean, they have five guys on the roster who have recorded a save. And then, of course, Ryan Yarbrough is doing his thing. So that's what I think has kept them afloat. Their bullpen, and then on top of it, the big boppers in the middle. Whether you mention them in Freeman, Otani, Will Smith, but Teoscar Hernandez has also been a stud. And they're just getting enough offensive production. Five innings, two runs from their starters, and then the bullpen is locking it down. Now, when they look bad, it's when the bottom of the lineup doesn't do a thing. It almost is Yankees-esque, where as long as Otani and Freeman are hitting, but the rest aren't, then they can fall into holes. So when evaluating them over the trade deadline, it's a little bit more challenging because, right, they need a third baseman now, but they have Max Muncy. They need a shortstop now, but they have Mookie Betts. There's just so many guys injured on this team that are going to come back. So where are the true holes? Like, do they really need, like, a big-time starting pitcher when they're going to get back an entire rotation soon? I don't really think they need a ton of bullpen arms. Maybe you go bargain hunting. So I have a few mock trades for them because they are the Dodgers. And you know that they're going to make a big splash just because they are the Dodgers, or at least that's what I'm assuming. And we also have a new report from Jesse Rogers, ESPN Insider. He believes that a Garrett Crochet trade to the Dodgers is inevitable, which was interesting.
Why would that be inevitable when the other report that came out on Thursday was that Crochet will not accept a move to the bullpen? And he feels that keeping the structure of being a starting pitcher is the thing that is best for his health.
Yeah, I don't think those two depart from anyone, depart from each other. What do you mean by that?
I think that the Dodgers were going to view Crochet as something to be, as someone to like be creative with. Okay, you have surpassed your innings, you know, your previous innings total by like nearly double at the point that we are acquiring you. Let's use you as a Swiss Army knife. Let's use you as a short starter or a long reliever, that kind of thing. Like, I know the idea of him being utilized out of the bullpen was certainly floated by contenders. And now Crochet's coming out and saying, like, no, I'm a starting pitcher. I'm going to start. So if the Dodgers are okay with letting him just go full bore, then, you know, so be it. Cool.
Yeah. I don't know if they are. And that's the beauty of the trade deadline is you get a report an hour and then an hour later you get a different report and you don't know if they're aligned, but I have a mock trade for Garrett Crochet to the Dodgers, but I also think there's a better avenue to not trade your ultimately best prospects and still get a ton of value. So we could go over both. Like, could they trade for Garrett Crochet and give them Dalton Rushing, Theron Loranzo, and Ronan Kopp?
That's not enough because Rushing and Theron Loranzo are both catchers. I think you would need DePaula in there as well. So I think it would be Rushing and DePaula.
Damn.
I know. And like, hey, do you want to do it? And Kopp is losing some value. Kopp's got an ERA in the high fives.
You know why I brought him up, though? Because he's 6'7". Because
he's 6'7", and he throws 100 like, miles an hour from the left side.
Like, we could just give him a younger version of him, sort of.
So I have him in a mock of my own.
Okay.
But I think it would need to be a better package than Rushing, Loranzo, and Kopp. I think it would
I don't think they should do that. Like, we can mock it. I think there's a better opportunity to get a starting pitcher and an outfielder in a twofer trade. And yeah, you're going to give up some prospect capital, but I don't even think it's going to be as much. Do you see where I'm going with this?
I do. I know Randy Arozarena has been a very popular name when it comes to the Dodgers trade deadline targets. Is that where you're going? Because I have one for Randy.
All right. I mean, I have a double. If they really want a starter, package Eflin and Randy Rosarena in the same deal from the Los Angeles Dodgers in exchange for DePaula, Diego Cartaya, and we could throw in another guy. I don't think it's going to be much more than that because Randy Rosarena, he does have 2.5 years of arbitration left, but Eflin is going to be a free agent soon. And those guys' value, I don't think, is super, super high. You're getting a blue chip, arguably the best prospect in the Dodger system. You could say it's DePaula. You could say it's rushing. I think you would say it's DePaula, or would you say it's rushing?
No, DePaula.
DePaula. So you're getting the best prospect in a pretty good Dodger system. Diego Cartaya, which maybe they'd want a reclamation catcher project like that.
He's lost a lot of value.
I know. But it's still DePaula and Cartaya.
Yeah, I think you would need to add one more.
I know. I agree. I said and a flyer.
Yeah.
But you think it has to be better than a flyer?
Maybe a bit better than a flyer. Like I know Kendall George kind of lacks some impact, but Kendall George could be a guy that goes who's like super speedy outfielder. Yeah, I like that. I actually go two bats from Tampa and an arm elsewhere.
Let's
hear it. My Randy Arozarena deal also includes Ahmed Rosario. Why not? Right? He's a rental. He's going to hit the open market again after this year. He was a decent Dodger for 2 weeks last year. Why not just do it again if you need 2 weeks to, you know, buy some time? Like, run the Ahmed Rosario thing back with Randy Arozarena, and you can do that for Dalton Rushing and Ronan Kopp. This would be the first time that Tampa has a legit catching prospect thing since, I think, Francisco Mejia, but he was acquired in a trade from the Padres. And Mejia, like, didn't work out, but Rushing is a better prospect than Mejia was.
I think it's
Rushing
too much.
You think it's too much?
Yeah, I do, because I think Ahmed Rosario almost has no value.
Yeah.
I think, like, getting even Nick Ahmed, just keep Nick Ahmed, and I think you just trade for Randy Arozarena. And,
you,
I mean,
really,
you still Miguel Rojas,
really
you got Lux.
You
got
really
Miguel Vargas. Go ahead.
You'd really rather have Nick Ahmed than Ahmed Rosario?
No, I wouldn't, but they're going to get back Mookie anyway. So do I want to make a trade and include Rushing in order to get two guys? No. And I don't think that they would have to part with Rushing in order to get Randy Arozarena. So I don't think that's worth it. I wouldn't do that if I were them.
Interesting.
But we're on the same path of Randy Arozarena is a great fit for them. Of course, they also need a proven playoff performer like that, or at least a guy known for the bright lights. Like, I love the fit for Randy in Los Angeles. I can't get that out of my head. So we're both aligned there. I would not trade Rushing. If that's what they're asking for Randy, no, I'm not doing that.
Why not? Because he's got two more years of control. He's a super two guy. And
because
this is far and away the worst year of his career.
Because I think, exactly. So why would you give up Dalton Rushing?
Because the Dodgers fix everybody.
I understand, but like, what is the best version of Randy Arozarena look like? Because the best version of Randy Arozarena during these regular seasons is not an elite player. I mean, he's a 20 home run, 20 steal guy, but he's not putting up no 140 WRC plus or anything like that. Like, this is a guy who's an above average hitter, who's not a good defender in the outfield. And yeah, he's going to hit some home runs. He's going to steal some bases. He's going to be exciting. And then you hope that this aura that he puts out during the big games continues. But I don't think that he's as valuable as a Dalton Rushing. I really don't.
So 141 games in 2021. He was a four-win player with a 127 WRC plus.
Yeah, it was his career year.
124 with a 2.9 war. 2023, 126 with a 3.1 war. That's a good player.
Yeah.
And you've got arguably the best player in the postseason that we have in baseball right now. Arozarena and Harper. There's a lot of value there. I understand that he's a one-win player right now. But, dude, we talk about how shit the year's been for Randy Arozarena. What's the WRC plus right now?
My guess is it's like 107.
110.
Yeah.
Okay? We're doomsdaying Randy Arozarena. He's got a 110 WRC plus.
I don't think we're doomsdaying him. I'm just saying that the peak of Randy Arozarena, you laid it out, is nothing better than a 127. Like, Dalton Rushing is a great prospect. Yeah, I mean, if you're the Dodgers and you don't give a shit, like, I can already hear my Dodger fan friends being like, Peter, we do not give a fuck. We do not care.
A 10-year deal. Like,
sure, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's the Dodgers. Like, I guess who cares? They can do it and they'll be fine. And Will Smith is their catcher of the future, right? So it's, you know, they already signed him to a 10-year deal. So where's rushing going to play anyway?
And by the way, you've got a fringe top 100 prospect in Tyron Lorenzo here too. So you have things coming. Like, don't worry about that.
No, I agree. I just think in a vacuum, if I'm looking at the value of Randy Rosarena and the value of Dalton Rushing, I think it's an overpay by the Dodgers personally. I still do. I think Dalton Rushing is a phenomenal prospect, and I'm just a little bit more down on Randy's value in totality than I think maybe you are. And I think that's just a difference of opinion on Randy, where I don't view him as this elite player, and I think to get an elite player, Dalton Rushing makes sense, and I don't view him as elite.
What do you think Amed Rosario's WRC Plus is right now? Because you said he's pretty much nothing.
I mean, they platoon him in spots, and I know that's what the Dodgers would do too. 258
plate appearances.
Tell me.
114.
Yeah. No, I know. They put him in positions to succeed. A lot of that is coming against left-handed pitching. He's a platoon bat, in my opinion.
So you have Randy Arozarena, who we just got into, and a solid platoon bat in Major League Baseball coming over to you for Dalton Rushing and a lefty flamethrower that can't really find the strike zone. I think that's worth it.
I don't. I think that's just a difference of opinion, but we're both in agreement because I don't want to spend due time just arguing over this mock that may not happen, but we should trade Randy Rosarena to the Dodgers.
Yeah.
That's what we should do. Do you like this trade of packaging Eflin in, get them a starter? They have that history with the Rays anyway. That's kind of why we're talking about this as well. And then you can put DePaula and potentially Laurent. You could put in Lorenzo as well. I don't know if that's too much too, but that's the same thing. But instead, we're getting Eflin instead of Amed Rosario, where I feel like they can just shoulder the load until Mookie gets back.
Yeah, I hear you. I think that would probably be the price. DePaula and Lorenzo for Eflin and a Rosarena, which is a doozy. Trade. And it's scary. Yeah. It's cool. The guy that jumped out to me, and a guy that is not going to cost much at all because he gets expensive for a small market team, and he was on, you know, a deal whose, you know, opt-outs and all that made a lot of sense. Like, he has a mutual option next year. I think Frankie Montas is going to cost nothing.
Yeah.
And I think the Dodgers would jump on an innings eater like Frankie Montas. So, like, Frankie Montas for Jake Gelof and a lottery ticket.
Sure.
Why not?
Yeah. No, yeah, I got no problem with that as well. Are we in this... in this mock world that we've created, are we getting Eflin and Randy and then also trading for Montas? Or are you saying without the Eflin side, that's another option they can go with?
It becomes an or. It becomes an or, an Eflin or a Montas.
Yeah, I say go get Eflin and Randy and let's run this thing. I mean, they've done it before, Scherzer and Trey Turner in the same deal. Let's do that. That's my favorite way of handling this deadline because it kills two birds with one stone. And yeah, you have to give up some prospects. But like Montas is going to lose them games, respectfully. Like, I don't really know what Montas is going to give them where Eflin can win them games. I think there's a difference there. It's like, now we'll give up the good prospects. I think that's the direction they should go.
So last devil's advocate that I have for you is 2025, you'd be paying a pretty penny for Zach Eflin when you already have Shohei Ohtani coming back, Yoshinobu Yamamoto, Tyler Glasnow, Gavin Stone, Bobby Miller. I mean, Knack, we'll see what happens free agency-wise. Do they retain Kershaw? Do they retain Buehler? That kind of thing. Dustin May will be back as well. I haven't even mentioned Robleski and River Ryan.
I think you're not worried about 2025. Like, maybe they are, but then if that's the case, if they're that worried about 2025, then they probably don't get a starter at all. Maybe a time buyer type pitcher. That's what they do.
And when
they
got Lance Lynn, time buyer.
Yeah, I could see them doing that. But do you want to win the World Series this year?
Yeah.
Montas doesn't help you do that. Eflin does. I think that's the difference.
Fair. I think
the Dodgers want to win the World Series every year.
Right. And I don't think Montas factors into their postseason rotation where Eflin would surely factor into their postseason rotation.
And Eflin even has experience in the bullpen. So if you turn him into what the Dodgers may have wanted from Crochet, Eflin can do that. And who knows, maybe he's super effective in a role like that. You never know.
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe pair him with Kershaw. Make a sick little playoff thing. I don't know.
Why not? All right, Padres?
Padres. Let's run it.
Okay. The San Diego Padres, here's the deal. They're 55-50 now following the Dylan Cease no-hitter. They're 7.5 back in the AL West. They're locked with St. Louis for the final wild card spot. San Diego has a very fun offense to look at until you get to like the 8-hole. And then the bench sucks to look at.
Yeah.
The rotation's really fun for like 3 guys. 4 guys. And then the 5th kind of stinks in Randy Vasquez. The bullpen is really good at the top, and then it falls off.
Yeah.
They lack depth.
Yes.
I want to
yes.
go get them depth.
I agree. So I texted our guy, Javier Reyes, who hosts Locked On Padres, and I said, what do you think the Padres' needs are? And he says, I want an elite relief pitcher, and I want a starting pitcher, but I don't want an elite starting pitcher, kind of is what his thoughts were like. He was like, I want a lockdown guy in the bullpen, not just bargain hunting for relievers. I want that to be the stake, as well as an Eric Fetty, Jack Flaherty type, not a Crochet or even reaching for a Skubal. But we also have to be, we have to monitor the Padres spending, right? Yeah. We can't just take on a bunch of more contracts. This isn't the same Padres that we're used to. So we also have to bargain hunt. So guys with a lot of years of control, they might not want those guys. But a guy like Eric Fetty, I think, is such a good fit. 2 years, $15 million. He's going to cost a decent chunk of prospects. I don't think anything is going to be crazy. And I know that I mentioned Jack Flaherty. I kind of have a new take about him. I know it has nothing to do with the Padres. I don't think the Tigers should trade him.
Why not?
I think they should keep him.
Why? No. So you say, I don't think the Tigers should trade him. I say, why not? And then your response is, I think they should keep him.
That's true. It's not a good response.
Yes, and? Let's do improv class. Yes, and?
That was good. No, I just think he's an absolute stud, and I'm thinking about the Tigers next year. I'm just drinking so much Jackson Job Kool-Aid, and I'm thinking, all right, the Tigers found a guy, clearly pitches well with them, looks great, is among the leaders in a lot of the ERA predictors, strikeout minus walk ratio. It's been an absolute stud. Maybe he's just should be a Tiger, and they extend him, and then we have a rotation of Skubal, Job, Flaherty, and Reese Olson next year. I mean, holy shit. That's fantastic. Yep.
The one problem is he may not like Detroit, and he's up after this year, so he could very well leave, and there are going to be 29 other teams that are vying for his services.
He could, and that's why if they have a conversation with him and he communicates that he would like to stay with the right price, then I wouldn't trade him. If he does say what you're saying, Jack, okay, yeah, let's trade him. But I would have the conversation with him first, because I'm kind of your Skubal rant plus Aram's Jackson Job content has landed me on, I want to keep Flaherty on the Tigers. It's your fault.
I don't really think it's my fault, because
your fault. It's Aram and your fault.
I mean, like, you could also do the Aroldis Chapman thing where like he disappears for 2 months and then he's back. Like, hey, it's really cool that Aroldis Chapman left for 3 months, won a World Series, and then came back. And oh, by the way, you got Gleyber Torres for it. I guess that could happen if he thinks about that fondly, but I don't see a world where Jack Flaherty agrees to an extension with the Detroit Tigers, but he's a Southern California kid that probably doesn't love Detroit, Michigan. And I, again, that's pure speculation, but I would think an LA native struggles a little bit to find his vibe in Detroit, Michigan. But
yeah, and I know he'd probably love to be a Dodger, and it makes sense to trade Flaherty to either the Dodgers or the Padres somewhere in Southern California. I totally get it. I'm just getting a little bit fired up about the Tigers. They're playing really well against the Guardians. I love their young pitching. And I'm like,
hitting's awesome. Keith is leveling up. Malloy is leveling up right now.
They're just exciting me right now. I'm just not desperate to be like, oh yeah, let's get rid of some of these good players. But it totally makes sense for them to do so. And we can include them in this. I just wanted to bring it up.
Got you. I looked actually lower than a Flaherty or a Fetty. I went again for like a twofer deal. Texas is selling off expiring pieces. Get me depth. Get me an innings eater and Michael Lorenzen, who's a better option than Randy Vasquez.
Yeah.
And Lorenzen is up. Like, I wouldn't float Gray because Gray's going to cost serious coin next year. Lorenzen doesn't. He's on the market again. Lorenzen, you also get Robbie Grossman there, too, to be a bench outfielder. Who's the outfielder on their bench right now on the active roster? Do you have the active roster in front of you?
I don't, but I can get it up in 0.8 seconds.
Yeah, so read me the bench and tell me that Robbie Grossman, even though he's having a down year by his standards, is not a drastic improvement from what they have on the bench.
You're also firing me up because I've always been a Robbie Grossman truther. So whenever we're talking the gross man, I'm in. Luis Campusano is backup catcher. Donovan Solano, who's like he's 36 years old. He's playing some third, some second. Tyler Wade, there's a little bit of everything. And Bryce Johnson. And Bryce Johnson is slugging 167 as their backup outfielder. So, correct. I would like you bring Tatis back, you move David Peralta down to the bench.
Okay, but Grossman, like Peralta's.
I wouldn't mind having Peralta and Grossman. Grossman is a switch hitter, too.
Why not? You can kind of, get Tyler Wade out of this whole jam, too. I know that he offers speed that Grossman doesn't have, but it's Tyler Wade at the end of the day.
The thing is, though, that's such a boring move. Like, yeah, it makes total sense, but like Preller, is Preller going to make these boring moves or is he going to overpay?
No, he's going to be crazy. I know that already.
I think we should go get Fetty, and I think we should also consider Pete Fairbanks from the Tampa Bay Rays.
Sure.
Potentially Kyle Finnegan from the Washington Nationals. Because if we're operating under what Javi was wanting, getting those elite relievers and an Eric Fetty, it's an excellent deadline for them. Now, maybe I don't think it's Fairbanks and Finnegan. Both have a little bit of control, but I noticed that Fairbanks is another guy with backloaded in his last year. Now, it's not up this year, but it is after next. So I'm thinking that the Rays are going to be interested in trading Pete Fairbanks either this deadline, during the offseason, or next deadline. But could they trade him this deadline if the Padres are so inclined? And I think Pete Fairbanks is a beast. I also think Kyle Finnegan has been fantastic too, but he's got an extra year of control as well. So they're going to cost a little bit, but they're not going to be crazy in terms of prospect capital. The Padres have the system to do it. I would go get Fetty, and I would go get one of these relievers, and we can then go bargain hunting for a reliever, like then go get Chafin or Shelby Miller from the Tigers, or just get someone kind of under the radar that Preller really likes. And I'll leave that up to him because he's a better scout than I'll ever be. Yeah. So you go bargain hunting for the reliever that you want, go get either or Finnegan, Pete Fairbanks, and then go get Fetty. So as the White Sox fan, what would you want for Eric Fetty from the Padres?
I'd want more than you would expect. But I don't think it would need to include Snelling or Lesko.
Does it have to include DeVries?
No.
Okay, good.
No. I view DeVries as like borderline untouchable at this point. He's up there with Salas because it's, teenager that's already off the complex and he's,
No, I agree.
Relatively speaking, balling. I don't know. It would probably be quantity over quality.
Would you want like a Mazer Pauly type package? More AAA guys that are due to be good. But is that the lane you want? Or do you want like 19-year-olds?
I want AAA guys.
You want AAA guys?
I would love Mazer Pauly. Yeah.
So Mazer Pauly for Fetty.
Yeah. Cool. Shake.
Do you even like that package?
What?
I don't mean to throw a wrench. Do you like that package, actually? Like, White Sox fans be like, oh, whoa.
It's Eric Fetty. He was in the KBO last year. You're playing with newfound coin.
It's a good point. No, I agree with you.
I know he's been all-star caliber this year, but again, you're playing with funny money at this point. I went Lorenzen and Grossman for Major and Victor Lizarraga, who is, low 90s arm that, is in AA right now, mixed results in AA. So, I mean, it's not sexy by any stretch. Yours is sexier. But, it turns into Fetty and then Finnegan, let's say, and you just deplete the system outside of the top five, which, is what they can do and is what they always do. And, when Juan Soto pops up, they usually deplete the top five. So
There you go. And then now you put Eric Fetty in this rotation, and I think the Padres are somewhat operating under, we have to expect that Darvish and Musgrove will not be the same guys when they come back and if they come back fully healthy.
Yeah.
So that's what I think they have to operate as, is that in a playoff rotation, Cease, King, Fetty, Waldron. And then if you get Darvish and Musgrove back, it's just a cherry on top of the sundae. It's not the ice cream.
Yeah.
And then if they get Musgrove and Darvish back, watch out if they look good. Because if they don't look good, like Joe Musgrove has this year, don't watch out. You won't really need to watch out. But
yeah,
maybe.
I have more faith in Darvish somehow, just, you know.
It's funny because Darvish is older, but I still have more faith. I agree.
Yeah. Dumb. That's what we got. That's the Padres. Cool.
So that's another deadline move potentially. It's just getting those two back. But yes, so we're trading for Kyle Finnegan or Pete Fairbanks. And we're trading for Eric Fetty. Now look at that bullpen. Now look at that rotation. It looks a lot better. And you don't have to trade from any of your top five prospects. I think that's the best way for the Padres to operate this deadline.
Got you. All right. We're going to do D-backs, Giants, Rockies in a moment. But before that, you need to tell us about a fun little tour we got going on next week.
Absolutely. The National League Central Tour presented by us here at Just Baseball and Snapback Sports. We're going to be there 5 games in 5 days in each of the 5 NL Central ballparks. And we truly, truly want you guys to come with. July 29th, we're going to be in Milwaukee. July 30th in St. Louis. July 31st in Cincinnati. And on July 31st, all of you Reds fans, we are going to be doing a live podcast from the BetMGM studio. It's either right near Great American Ballpark or it's in Great American Ballpark. That's on me for not even knowing, but it will be in that vicinity. We're doing a live podcast on the day of the deadline. So any Reds fans, if they want to get tickets to the game, they can come with us that beforehand. And then we're all going to go to the game together, drink a couple beverages, and enjoy the Cubs taking on the Reds in Great American Ballpark. August 1st, we head to Wrigley. That's almost sold out already. And August 2nd, D-backs versus Pittsburgh Pirates to end the tour at PNC. The link to purchase tickets is in the episode description, as well as our link tree on social media. Use code JUSTBASEBALL for $5 off your purchase. We're going to be doing exclusive giveaways at each stop. Even in Pittsburgh, we're talking about potentially a fan batting practice, stuff like that. You're going to get a ton of merch, plenty of giveaways, and hang out with the three of us. It's going to be an absolute blast. Be on the lookout. We did a flash sale that unfortunately is over by the time you're hearing about it, but we're going to be doing some dynamic pricing. You'll see on our social media. So be on the lookout for that. It's going to be an absolute blast. We hope everybody can join us.
It's going to be excellent. Excellent, excellent. All right, let's jump into the Arizona Diamondbacks here. The Arizona Diamondbacks, as it stands right now, are a half game back, the final wild card spot in the National League. They are 8 back in the West. They're 53-50 at time of recording. Arizona has an offense that is pretty much set. And I was almost viewing them as sellers until the last week or so. And now I'm like, wait, hold on. They're actually going to probably go for this thing.
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned semi-seller in San Francisco, semi-buyer in Arizona. They should do this. So I thought Jock Peterson was as good as gone. No, like Jock is going to be huge for them in the final 2 months of the season.
So Jake Oliver, who writes for Sports Illustrated, covers the Diamondbacks. He wrote, the Arizona Diamondbacks are likely buyers at the trade deadline. Beyond needing a potential starting pitcher and a guaranteed left-handed reliever, there's a chance that Mike Hazen, the GM for the Diamondbacks, might be looking for a power-hitting bat. So if we're looking at that as their three needs, I think that's what we should be operating on. So potentially on the looks for a starting pitcher, but I don't think they're going to be in the market for a big-time ace.
No chance.
You just got Jordan Montgomery back. You're going to get Merrill Kelly back. We hope you get Eduardo Rodriguez back. And then, of course, Gallen is not looking like the best version of Gallen, but he's still working his way back, and I'll obviously give him the benefit of the doubt. It's freaking Zach Gallen for crying out loud. But I agree with that. I looked at their bullpen. They definitely need a left-handed reliever, and I found a couple high-end, medium-end, low-end, and I have the perfect starting pitcher for them to get as well. And in terms of power bats, I didn't understand that. I don't understand why they think that they need more power bats. I mean, you got Peterson, who I know gets subbed out against lefties, but Christian Walker is still a beast. Ketel Marte is everything in one. Eugenio Suarez has been heating up. Diamondbacks, we all see that happening. I don't think they need a power bat. Like, we can talk about him. I don't think they need one. And maybe if they do, it's like a Juan Yepes from Washington or something like that.
I mean, Yepes was just kind of sitting there hanging out in Rochester for a while. So,
yeah, I don't know. Maybe I don't know how much it would cost, but I just saw him hit a home run the other day. So I was like, oh, maybe he would do me in that. I don't know. But I just didn't understand the power bat dynamic. Do you think I'm overlooking that or you agree?
No, I don't think you're necessarily overlooking that. I think Alec Thomas being back is big, and you don't think power bat when you think Alec Thomas, but that's, you know, borderline everyday player, at least bulk end of a platoon player that you've got going on. Gino, you're right. Like, Gino has gotten a little bit better, but he's still OPSing well under league average, but he's got two homers in his last four games. He just homered, you know, last time out last night, Wednesday night.
Did you see how high that home run was?
No, is it like a Torrey Taylor punch? Shout out the Iowa Hawkeyes.
41 degree launch angle at 110. I tweeted about it. I think it was the highest home run of the year. Like, I've seen a lot of home runs this year. I don't think I've seen a higher home run.
Give it to me. I love it. I viewed starting pitching depth as the thing. I think that bullpen's pretty good. Seawald's been very, very shaky in the closer spot, but
I don't love the bullpen.
Really?
I don't. I love Martinez, but he's not perfect. He looks perfect when he throws. Like, this guy is as nasty as anybody, but he's not perfect. And
my thing is, how many good bullpen arms do you need? Because Seawald is Seawald. Like, for better or worse, he's, you know, a leverage reliever.
I think
probably the closer for the Diamondbacks.
I think we make a splash here, and I think they can do it. And I don't think it's that expensive. I was asking Arm what the package looks like for Tanner Scott. It's not as much as I think people think. So I got a mock for Tanner Scott. They need a powerful left-handed reliever. You put Scott in the closer role, move Seawald, Ginkle, and Martinez down. Now I'm in love with your bullpen. I don't think that Seawald's like the lockdown closer, and I think Ginkle's better in the seventh, and Martinez is better in the sixth. Like, that's kind of how I view this bullpen. I'd love to get Tanner Scott.
What do you do with Ryan Thompson at that
point? Ryan Thompson, I love too. Keep him. They're all like, this is now a great bullpen.
Gotcha. Are there enough innings to go around?
Yeah. I mean, you're going to need all these guys anyway. Come playoff time, definitely. I mean, we remember Sal Frank caught fire. Like, they needed him a ton. You need at least five guys if we're talking about an elite playoff bullpen.
Yeah.
And I think Tanner Scott puts the cherry on the cake. But if we don't want to trade for him, Taylor Rogers, potentially of the San Francisco Giants. 2.27 ERA has been fantastic. Unrestricted free agent in 2026. I think you got to bypass a year of arbitration there. That could be a deal.
He's a reliever making $12 million next year. I think it's $12 or $13 million.
That's why it's going to cost almost nothing when it comes to prospect capital.
Correct.
Or you give up a fine prospect and the Giants eat some of that money. Do the Giants really want to pay him $12 million?
No.
I don't think so either. No. And then also just an easy one, you could just say, go get Chafin. He's your Sal Frank of last year during the postseason.
Yeah.
Guy just is super solid every single time.
Yeah.
I like those three levels, but we were talking about Augustin Ramirez and Jared Serna from the Yankees for Tanner Scott. The Diamondbacks can make a move like that. And I was thinking if the Marlins potentially want, I feel like they're always in the market for these 19-year-old infielders. The Diamondbacks have two of them, Johnsel Luis and Ruben Santana. Again, I'm not the prospect guy, so I wanted to throw that over to you. That was a package of two of their close to top 10 prospects, 19-year-old infielders. I thought the Marlins might say yes to that. I don't know.
I'm not the 19-year-old infield guy, so I'd be talking out my ass. So I'm going to save myself from talking out my ass. But I think one 19-year-old infielder is going to, you know, maybe be the price for Zach Littell from Tampa.
Ugh.
I know you say ugh, but we're looking for a five-starter.
I have one for you that I still don't think is going to be super, super expensive.
Better or worse than Littell?
Better.
Okay.
Cal Quantrill. Cal Quantrill is such a good fit for the Diamondbacks. when he was at his best, actually, he's been so good for the Rockies. So, but that year, the legendary Cal Quantrill year with,
yeah,
with Cleveland.
Yeah.
When he's at his best, he is pitching to contact, to weaker contact. And when a great defense is behind him, he works like clockwork. This is bang, 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 bang. That's what Cal does. The Diamondbacks defense, and it's a pretty big stadium as well. I love the fit. He's also been pitching in the National League West, has had great starts against the Giants, great starts against the Padres. Now, against the Dodgers, it's been a little rocky, but I don't know how many pitchers you're going to find who dominate the Dodgers. He's also, he went to college at Stanford. I know he's a Canadian, but there's that West Coast thrill. I don't know. I'm kind of pulling shit out of my ass now. Yeah. That last part I'm pulling out of my ass.
Okay.
But I still think it's such a good fit for this Diamondbacks team. I really do. And I think that he could potentially be in your playoff rotation if you need him.
He could absolutely be in your playoff rotation. I like that. I think that he's going to be much more expensive than a Littell. But again, you pay for success.
3 months of him.
I thought he had another arb year.
Does he have another arb year?
I thought so.
He might. I don't really know what the value is in a package for him. I wasn't able to find a mock because I also know that I value him higher than probably everybody on the market.
He's got another arb year. He's making 6.5 this year, so he would elevate to probably 9 or 10 next year.
I mean, I don't think he would take one of the elite prospects that the Diamondbacks have.
No, not the elite, like not a Lawler or anything. Maybe like a Gino Groover, but that farm system is not good.
Okay, trade a Gino Groover for Cal Quantrill.
You need more. Like, he's the starting point.
Give him another flyer. That's a trade that can be made. You can get Quantrill and Tanner Scott in this deadline without going to your best prospects.
And that makes them objectively better.
Objectively better. That was my plan for them.
Cool.
What are your you like that plan?
I like that plan. Yeah, I mean, like, Littell, I just viewed as a warm body that could get them through 5-6 innings 20% of the time. But Quantrill's objectively the better option.
But he's not so much better of an option that it's so much more expensive, too. It's like, I think it's the perfect better option without actually being super expensive. Yeah.
Now, let's go get Garrett Crochet.
Yeah, exactly. Like, Garrett Crochet is a better option than Zach Littell, but he's way more expensive. Right. So, Littell adjacent, but better, I think. And then Quantrill just in that stadium with that defense behind him, I think would work so well.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, two more. The two sellers.
Are the Giants a seller fully? I think they
are. Soft seller.
Yeah.
They're 49-54. They're 12 back in the West. They're 4.5 back in the final wild card spot. Now, for reference, 4.5 back does not sound like a lot. Jed Hoyer's already packed it in on the north side of Chicago, and they're 5 back. So that should tell you all you got to know. I also saw somewhere Carter Hawkins, and I'm going to do a Twitter search of Carter Hawkins' name. Carter Hawkins is the GM of the Cubs. The president of baseball operations is Jed Hoyer. This was on 670 The Score on the morning show. Carter Hawkins on the Justin Steele trade rumors. Quote, any opportunity you have to increase your side of the ledger, you should at least listen. Are we stupid?
No, that sounds like a quote that I would make if I was running a team. It actually sounds, did I make that quote? Because what have I said for my entire life on this podcast? I would listen to anybody. Now, am I going to accept it? Probably not. But I you know what? No, you're going to try and spin that into something bad. I love that. Sure, listen. Let's see what you give. Will somebody overpay? Maybe. If not, we won't trade them.
Justin Hawkins. Steele is the Cubs, man. He's the guy. He's the steady presence in the Cubs rotation.
And if the Orioles offered you Jackson Holliday and Sammy Blasio for
not happening.
Exactly. But that's what I'm saying. Like, maybe somebody gets desperate. You never know. And Justin Steele is as good as anybody on earth. So you never know. I love that.
I read that and I was just like, what are we doing here?
Doesn't that not sound like I would make that comment?
Yeah, but also like, it's probably just, you know, that classic throwaway line off the top where it's like, we're not moving him, but, you know,
they're not going to move him unless somebody sends them a stupidly huge package that they can't refuse, and then they'll do it. But
But jumping back to the Giants, you're not moving Robbie Ray because Robbie Ray is the best pitcher on the planet. I think he is. He's the only starting pitcher to have allowed zero hits so far this season.
Good point.
Is that right? Do I have that right?
Sounds like it.
I think I have that right. I didn't say qualified. I just said just only starting
starters. Pitcher.
There's probably one opener that made like one appearance and it was two hitless innings and they're back in Reno or some shit. And it's like, oh man, Jack is cooked.
We'll go with your narrative saying that Robbie Ray is the only starter without any hits this year.
They're not moving Ray. They should move Snell because he's got a player option at $38 million next year. You don't want to risk him picking that up on your team.
Are you? Yeah. I mean, does any other team want to risk him? At the same time, like, he's been really, really good in his last few starts. Are they going to sign him to this deal and move him immediately? Like, maybe. I was poo-pooed when I mentioned Jaime Candelario potentially being on the move from the Reds.
Because he's a longer-term deal. Snell was a 1+1.
Yeah, it is a 1+1. No, I listened to your guys' points. You guys made some good points on this.
Snell has gone 5 shutout, 7 shutout, 5 innings, 1 hit. 7 innings, 1 hit. 6 innings, 4 hits, 2 earned. That's a really good stretch of 3 starts. And somebody's going to get sold on that.
Yeah.
Would it be me if I were a GM? No, but like I had something against Snell deep down last year when he won the Cy Young Award.
I don't know which team has taken on that money. I don't know. Even just after 3 starts, because I think everybody knows that he's as good as anybody when he's right, but you're taking a big risk there, and that's why I think the market and free agency materialized like it did. It's gonna be tough to move him. I would be pretty surprised if they did, but like you and Arm said, I could see it.
Yeah.
I think it's unlikely though.
No, we already traded Lamont Wade.
Yes, we did. I also think that Michael Conforto could potentially be on the move. He's an unrestricted free agent in 2025, corner outfielder in a market that isn't deep with those type of bats. He's not going to net you a ton, but he at least will net you something.
Yeah.
I wonder if a team would be interested in Alex Cobb because his rehab, at least the word is that he looks good. He's also an unrestricted free agent next year. Maybe you get a fresh arm. It's not going to cost a team much. But, like, I'd be intrigued by an Alex Cobb if I were a contender.
Sure.
So, that's another one. Like I said, the Rogers brothers, they're both free agents in 2026. I could see them potentially being on the move. And last one is Mike Yastrzemski. That's what the Giants have. And they're outside of Lamont Wade, who I really would want. I would want the Rogers brothers, but they're not chips that are going to get you. Like the White Sox when they have a Fetty or a Crochet or a Luis Robert. It's not that kind of deadline for them. It's a positioning type deadline. Move off some money that you don't project as part of your future while still operating under a notion that we can compete next year if we get it right in the offseason, but kind of move off some contracts that you don't really see yourself moving forward with.
Much like the Tigers, if you take Flaherty out of the equation, and we are taking Flaherty out of the equation because Peter already extended him because he loves Detroit.
No, I agree. I am taking him off the market.
Yeah, so it's a lot like the Detroit situation where they're just trimming fat, and they have an idea of what they want the next good Giants team to look like, and a lot of those guys are on the roster. Some of those guys are on the roster. Other ones, just move them. Like, move them, recoup whatever you can value-wise, and call it a day. And I think that's what they're going to do. The one that is going to hurt is Lamont Wade because he's been a good presence over the last several years. But, you know, the Rogers brothers, like, it's fine. I know Tyler's been a Giant for a while, but Tyler, at the end of the day, throws 83 miles an hour. And, it comes from a funky slot. I know. Huge asterisk next to it. But, like, Taylor, again, he's making about $12 million next year.
He's expensive.
The only way this thing gets really frisky is if they listen on Doval. And I don't think they will.
I don't think they
that's
will
the
either.
Only way that this gets at all sexy for the Giants.
You don't think there's any chance in the world they listen on Webb, do you?
Zero chance in the world. Zero.
Not even one? No, I was kidding. Zero. I don't think they're going to trade him. He's their guy.
Anytime you have the opportunity to what? Increase your ledger, you think about it. What did Carter Hawkins say? I already forgot. I already pushed it out of my mind.
Exactly. I'm pro Carter Hawkins. I think I like that quote. No, but I don't think they'll listen on Webb unless they were just to get blown away by a prospect package, which they won't, and they are not going to trade him because he's also such a good fit for Oracle, and he's just a giant. Those were all the guys that I had. And again, I apologize to Giants fans, just like I apologized to Rangers fans yesterday. I always want to give fans of these certain teams just a banger of a deadline preview. But unfortunately, we're not going to serve you a bunch of bullshit on a platter that we don't believe. This is what we believe the Giants deadline is going to look like. Soft selling guys who are not a part of your future. And we outlined all of them. If they trade Snell, I'll be pretty surprised. And I'd be so fascinated to see what the prospect package would be for that. You guys talked about that, correct? What did you identify, if anything?
Snell, we didn't really identify a package. I don't know what it would look like. I think it'd pretty darn cheap because, again, the Giants are trying to get out from under $38 million possibly next year.
Would the Dodgers want to add him?
No, I don't think so.
I'm just thinking about what teams would want to add potentially that size of contract and then prospects. Like the Yankees, I don't know if I see that. Maybe they get desperate Soto, but they kind of already have the rotation. I'm thinking about potentially the Phillies, but do they really want to do that when their rotation is that good right now?
No.
The Brewers ain't doing it.
You know who could is Atlanta.
Padres, again.
Atlanta.
That much money, though, that's not in their DNA.
It's not in their DNA, but if they took it
just get
a rental,
different starter.
I agree, but like if they knew that it was just going to be a rental and he was going to opt out and sign a multi-year deal.
I mean, didn't you guys mention him to the Twins? Was that the team that
Minnesota. But again, Minnesota is in kind of a TV rights pinch right now.
Yeah, I just they don't have the money. And then the Guardians, they wouldn't do it either. I mean,
see if there's a market for him.
Would the Royals get crazy? That's a team that might be a sleeper in there.
I don't think
because they're playing really good baseball right now. And if they just want to make a big splash and they're willing to take on the money and take the risk, like I could see the Royals being a team. That's the only team really that makes like sense to me because the Orioles are not going to want to take on tons of money. They'd rather give you prospects for it. The Red Sox aren't going to do that either. I kind of think the Royals, I'm getting into that one a little bit.
It's such a small market.
I know
but that they allocated a bunch of money, but like them possibly being tied to 38 for Snell next year is a shit ton of money.
Yeah, but he might take the risk. I don't know. Maybe not. But I think they make me the most happy. They make my brain feel the softest.
Good. I'm glad you're happy.
I am happy.
Yeah.
Should we unfortunately talk about Rocktober?
Yeah, we can. I don't have much on them. The Colorado Rockies, they're 38-65 at time of recording. They're 23 back in the West. They're 15.5 back in the wild card. I mean, sell whoever has value here. Elias Diaz.
Yep.
You absolutely sell.
Jacob Stallings.
Stallings, for sure. Brendan Rodgers, you sell. If you can get something back for Brendan Rodgers, go ahead and do it. McMahon's an interesting one. I say yes.
I say yes too, but they say no.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That's why I didn't, you know, Yankee fans, I got a couple DMs. Why didn't you mock McMahon to the Yankees? Because I don't think the Rockies are going to trade him. That's what I responded to them, and that's what I'm saying now. Yeah. For whatever reason, McMahon's their guy, and all power to you, Colorado.
Yeah.
So
who is untouchable on this Rockies team? Tovar? Well, Jones, Doyle.
Yeah.
In the lineup.
I mean, I would trade Vodnik now. He's a reliever doing well for them. Get him out. As soon as you find a reliever doing well for you, trade him.
They
or extend him
Justin
like you did
Lawrence
with Daniel Bard
last year when they had the chance.
Exactly. Like, don't make that same mistake again. Trade Victor Vodnik. I think Gomber could have some value. He's a free agent in 2026. Maybe they want to keep him. And then we've already talked about Quantrill at length. Like Jalen Beeks is an interesting reliever Former Ray is decent.
He's not good enough.
Opener, somewhat of a thing.
Again, I think they're going to move whoever has value. I just don't know how many guys have value outside of building blocks. I think Elias Diaz has some value.
Quantrill.
Quantrill has value.
Gomber.
McMahon has value, but again, you just
like that. Do they want to trade anyone of value? Like, I haven't heard anything from them.
Elias Diaz is as good as gone. Elias Diaz is gone.
We think. And what would they even get for him?
Not much.
Sure, he's gone. Stallings, maybe. This sucks.
It does suck.
Because we could be more creative if we knew their plan.
Correct.
But we don't. We just know that they are sellers and that they don't want to trade McMahon. And then if you don't want to trade your blue chip and you're not trading from your core, the Rockies have 38 wins for a reason.
Yeah.
It's because the rest of these guys don't really have any value outside of Quantrill. He's in a different boat. He's in the Hall of Fame boat. So that's a blue chip.
Silver lining, Brenton Doyle could go 2020 playing the best defense like ever.
He has been. I'm shocked, genuinely. If anybody watched him offensively last year, I did not see this coming. Shout out Brenton Doyle. I saw it coming with Ezekiel Tovar. I think we all did. But Doyle, I had no idea. And then on the flip side, I thought Nolan Jones could go like was going to go crazy, and then he's not been any good. Colorado's weird. I don't know how to evaluate them. I've almost stopped like putting them in any of my bets moving forward. Like, I don't know what they're doing. That's it.
That's it. Do the merch thing, man.
Hopefully everybody has an amazing weekend, and please, please, please keep on the lookout for these NL Central road trip tickets. It means a ton to us. It's our first time doing something. Any and all support that we can get from you guys would mean the absolute world to us, especially Reds fans. Our first live podcast on the deadline day at the BetMGM studios. Then we're going to the Reds game. You gotta come through. Reds fans have been amazing to us. Please support us for our first ever live podcast. And as well, make sure check out Game Time. Tickets beyond this, $20 off first purchase using code Just Baseball. BetMGM, code Just Baseball as well for that first bet. Offer up to $1,500. And for everybody again listening, if you're not in the area, just rate and review 5 stars on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and subscribe on YouTube. Best way to support the show. For Jack McMullen, I am Peter Apple. Have a great weekend, everybody. And with that, thank you, everybody.